So it's a pleasure to be here. It's good to see so many of you turn out. And as we've discussed already, these are the Thimble Islands. Hopefully we can all see and enjoy the picture of the Thimble Islands. I'm going to talk about age-related macular degeneration. And some of you may actually have that disease. More likely, you know somebody who has this disease. It's become one of the most common forms of blindness, especially with the aging population. Thank you. The numbers tell you a little bit about how big this problem is, and it's a worldwide problem. And to give you a sense of what this disease is like, this is what sighted people see. Someone with macular degeneration, this is what they would see. And one of the important things to realize is that this part of their vision is normal. This is the disease part. And I can demonstrate that. If you want to understand how a person with macular degeneration sees, you might look at, put your thumb, cover one eye, with your thumb, move your thumbnail so it covers the faces, and then try to read estimated increase. And as long as you're focused on your thumbnail covering the faces, this should look very blurry to you. Okay? And this is because different parts of the eye use different things. What we consider to be seeing is this, but this is also an important part of seeing. And so that's what we want to spend a little bit of time on. So what we've done here is taken an eye and sliced it. Imagine if you took a saw and sliced through my head like this, right? Don't try this at home. You slice through it and then look down. And so now you're looking on top of the eye. We see here's the optic nerve. Here's the lens. Here's the cornea, right? So if you touch the cornea, that'll hurt. Behind this is the iris, the colored part of the eye. The little hole in the center is the pupil, the lens. And the light gets back here. And we have this thin tissue called the retina. Now, there's a special part of the retina called the macula. And this is the part that's responsible for seeing, as you normally describe it. But I'm going to show you how this part of seeing is very important in your life, and it's not one that you realize all the time. If we were to take this and look at it magnified, this is not a drawing, this is actual tissue, and it's stained in a way that we can see the different layers of the retina. And we'll be talking a lot about the retinal pigment epithelium, RPE. And this is a very, very important tissue. It put three of my kids through private school and college. So when the doctor looks through your eye, you know, they take that bright light and they shine it in your eye, they can only see what's in this blue circle. Okay, so they don't see the whole retina. Of course, they can look for here. You know, they stand there with this thing and they go this way and this way. And what they're doing is shining their tunnel vision, you know, to focus here or to focus here. But this picture is just this part right here, okay? And you can see the optic nerve, and we know that's the optic nerve because there's no pigment epithelium over the top of it. So the light shines brightly back to you. And these are all blood vessels that come out the center of the optic nerve. And in fact, these are the only blood vessels you can see without cutting the body. So a lot of what the doctor's doing looking in your eye is noting something about hypertension or vascular disease. But the other thing you might notice is here is this area with no blood vessels, or very few. That corresponds to this region called the macula, and this is the region that gets diseased. One reason we have such high visual acuity here is that we're not blocked by blood vessels. Okay. The other reason is the retina gets very thin in the center. So, you know, it's kind of odd. The light comes through here, and so it comes through here, and it goes through all these layers of cells before it gets here to the photosensitive part. And you say, well, why would you go through all this and have the photosensitive part down here? Well, the fact is, this tissue is perfectly clear. It's only because we've used the stain that we can see the different features that I'll go into in some detail. So let's go with this idea that different parts of the eye have different functions. And for this, we need to do a few experiments, and I need a volunteer. I'm not looking at you. I'm looking at your pocketbook because my volunteer needs a chair. My volunteer needs a chair. And I need another chair.
I can get you another chair. Just
okay. So I need a volunteer from the audience to sit with me for a moment. And yes, so come on up. You will be on Brantford TV. So, I mean, just to be truth in
yeah, that's true.
And on YouTube and all of that. Hi, my name's Larry.
Eva Besmer.
Eva, thank you for joining and cooperating. So I'm going to pull up close a little bit like this. And your task is very difficult. You have to stare at my face and not look away. I want you to stare right here, okay? And I want to ask you if you could see my thumb, mm-hmm. Okay? How about now? Mm-hmm. How about now?
I saw it move. I wouldn't.
Yeah. So, but you can't see it. How about now?
Now it's back.
Now it's back, and now you can't see it. How about now?
It's wiggling. I see it.
You see it wiggling. So we have different parts of the eye. That are a motion detector, and that's all it can do, and other parts that can see, but not with any visual acuity. So let's test that idea out. So how many fingers am I holding up?
Three.
Three. Wow, that's pretty good. Eyes right here. How many fingers am I holding up?
Four.
How about now?
Three.
Eyes right here. How about now?
Two.
How about now?
Don't know.
Okay, so when she's focused right here, she could see fingers and distinguish fingers out to about here, and then as we get farther out, she can't see anymore. Or she sees something, but because most of the eye is about seeing motion, seeing broad shapes, okay, and seeing low light vision. So most of the eye is, that's what it does, and that's what a rodent eye would do, a nocturnal eye would do. They can see, but they really can't read the paper or recognize a face. Let's have a round of applause. Thank you. Well, a mouse eye, a rat eye, it can see light and shadow. It could see at night. Nocturnal animals also have a special feature in the eye that I don't want to go into, but most eyes, most animal eyes, operate that way. We primates, pigs, as I'll tell you a little later, have a region that is better at visual acuity. Okay, so let's look at one of the behaviors of someone with macular degeneration. They can't read the newspaper, they can't see, recognize a face, but they can get up at night to go pee and they don't trip over anything. At least no more likely than you or I, because their night vision works. Their motion vision works, and they can navigate the world very well. They have no problem walking into this room, finding a chair, and sit down. But they can't read. And if you can't read the Shoreline Times, I think you'll agree that quality of life goes way down. So let's look at a few diseased eyes. So I showed you a normal eye, and the trick to this is always to find the optic nerve. Okay, because sometimes I'll show you a right eye, sometimes a left eye. But if you get orientation, we have the optic nerve, we have the blood vessels coming out, and we see these bright reflective things. Any German speakers here? You know, what is a Druse? Drusen, yeah. Is what?
I thought it was a gland.
Well, actually, a Druse is a rock, and Drusen is plural. So there are lots of rocks in the back of the eye. At least that's the descriptive term that was used. Now the German speakers are shaking their heads and stuff, and that's going to blow my story up. But but in somebody's language, Druse means rock, and Drusen is the plural. And so you have all these bright reflective things. And you'll notice they're right in the area of the macula. Now this person doesn't necessarily have macular degeneration, but that's certainly one of the risk factors for macular degeneration. Now, if we look at one of the advanced stages of this, here you see this area, you can see these blood vessels. Notice here's the optic nerve. Here are the blood vessels coming out. This is the position of the macula. You don't see blood vessels here, but that's because this pigment epithelium, this layer of the eye that's black, has disappeared. And we're seeing blood vessels on the other side of the pigment epithelium. So these are blood vessels in the choroid. And I'll show you a diagram of that later on. Let's go.
What's
the drusen made of? And that's a great question. So it's a lot of lipid, a lot of fatty material. It's a lot of cholesterol. At one time, folks speculated maybe this is like an atherosclerotic plaque, but that's been disproven. And a lot of the reason it develops, I want to describe in a later slide. So hold on to that question for a moment. This is another form of the disease. Look for the optic nerve head. Okay, here's the macula. And here's blood between the pigment epithelium and the photosensitive parts of the cell. So we have bleeding in here. This is known as the wet form of macular degeneration. We call this lesion choroidal because the blood vessels came from the choroid. Neovascularization, new vessels, new blood vessels. So blood vessels where they don't belong, and these folks will lose vision very quickly. Fortunately, this is the only form of the disease that we know how to treat. And I'll say a little bit about how that works later. But I want to show something, a contrasting disease. Okay. So I told you that you know, we can only see this bit with the optic nerve and macula, and that's all we can see. So to take this picture, we actually took a lot of pictures and stitched them together into one. So here's the optic nerve, blood vessels, avascular, non-vascular part, and we see all these black things. This is actually pigment epithelium that's clumped together. It's no longer doing its job. And the disease is all out in the periphery. So what do you imagine somebody with this disease, what would they see? I'm seeing people make motions. You would be tunnel vision. So this would be, they could recognize faces, they could read books, but they have poor night vision, and they have tunnel vision. Glaucoma is another kind of disease that would give this kind of visual field in its extreme.
I'm sorry, what is this disease that's...
This particular disease, this is retinitis pigmentosa. Okay. Yeah, it's a genetic disease. There are 100 different versions of this disease, but they all seem to present this way. So hopefully you're getting good at this. Can anyone point out where's the optic nerve on this one?
Right
Yeah, the people are sort of pointing to over here. Actually, this is a picture of Mars. So, and so, this is to say, you know, that we're going into foreign territory now. And so we have to start talking about how did the eye form, so that we can understand the different parts of it and why they act different ways. And so the brain starts out as a long tube, the brain and spinal cord, a long tube lined by cells. And in the head, where this tube gets larger, there are two branches. We call it the optic vesicle. So here's the lumen of this neural tube. And it continues out to be the lumen of the optic vesicle. So you could think of this as a balloon. And you notice I've color-coded the balloon because different parts of this tissue are going to become different things. The black part is going to become the pigment epithelium. The blue part, where I'm going to ignore for most of this talk, the red part is going to become the retina. The lens actually comes from the skin, and where this part of the optic vesicle touches the skin, it induces skin to form lens. So this has a different embryonic origin. But what I want you to think about is taking your fist and pushing it into this balloon. And if you did that, you'd push this red layer up against the black layer. Okay, so the space here is your fist. This will be is called the vitreous. And when we give drugs for the wet form of macular degeneration, we inject them into the vitreous. Your base of your hand is the lens. Your wrist is in this hole here. Okay, so this is the pupil of the eye. This part of the blue is the iris. This part of the blue is the ciliary body. And I'll mention those later. The ciliary margin is just where blue turns to red, where ciliary body becomes retina. And you'll see it becomes thicker. And this is this part, the fovea. Notice light coming straight through hits the fovea. This is the most highest visual acuity and the best color vision. But it's not very good at night vision. Okay, so we have created what we would call a potential space. This real space, the lumen of the optic vesicle, became a potential space. So think of my shirt and my undershirt. There is no space between my shirt and my undershirt. But I can slip my hand in there and create a space. I didn't have to tear any tissue. This is now a real space. Now it's a potential space. When fluid gets into this potential space, we call it a detached retina. Okay. So, and as we go through, we're going to intentionally make a localized detached retina. So let's take a little bit of this retina and let's look at it in higher magnification. And you can see it's all these layers, and it's a lot like a club sandwich. And not just any club sandwich. For those of you who like the cartoon Blondie, those of a certain age, you remember Dagwood Bumstead. And so this is the Dagwood Club. You Google it. That's where I just Googled Dagwood Club, and this is what we came up with. And we've got five layers of bread here, with goodies in between the bread. And they can correspond to each of the of these layers. Now, we have this layer up here, which are bundles of nerve projections that are going to different parts of the brain. That's the garnish on top. We have this collection of cells that we call ganglion cells. The names don't matter, but that's a slice of bread. All the slices of bread are a collection of these cells, cell nuclei. So we have one for bipolar cells, one for photoreceptors, one slice of bread for pigment epithelium, one slice of bread for the choroid, where the blood vessels are. And then we have stuff in between the slices of bread. So different kinds of meat. Between the choroid and the pigment epithelium, we just have a smear of mustard and mayonnaise. So that's very thin. But the photoreceptor layer has these little projections out between it and the pigment epithelium. And this is where light is detected. So light hits here, sends a signal through this cell, connects to this cell, relays the signal to these cells, sends the information to these bundles, and it goes to the brain. So let me say that again, but with a simplified diagram. So, yes, question in the back.
Are the rods and cones the ones on the bottom?
Yes. So these are rods and cones, and schematically, the rods are kind of straight, and here they look more like a cone. It'd be hard to pick them out from this stain. So here's my one slice of bread, the mustard mayonnaise, the pigment epithelium. So all of these blue dots here, we've just shown one row of them, just so that we could show that this cell has a long projection that has some fancy structure to it, and that receives the light. And it has another projection that goes and meets the green cells. So all of this stuff in here is the roast beef. Then up here, these cells, we call them bipolar cells, connect to ganglion cells. They meet in the middle. Their long processes meet in the middle. Okay, so this was the ham. And we have to wonder, why is this so complicated? If we're going to have a light signal here, go to this signal, go to this cell, go to this cell, why not just one cell that sends its projection all the way? And the answer is these blue cells. These blue cells come in two layers, one down in here and the other up in here. And what they do is send information laterally. They send it side to side. So in other words, if this cell is in the light and this cell is in the dark, that information gets put together. That's how we can get a sharp edge. So this is an integrated circuit. This is processing information. Okay, so this is not a piece of film. That's a bad analogy, because film, you see what you get. And I can demonstrate that. Have you ever looked on a beautiful, somewhat overcast day? There are wonderful clouds in the sky and the trees of the forest and all of this, and you go to take a picture, and you don't see that beautiful view. You either see the clouds in focus and the scenery in the foreground is washed out, or you could focus on the trees and then the clouds all look washed out. You kind of have to be a master photographer or have an iPhone to take that picture properly. And it's because the iPhone has an integrated circuit that's processing the information to get everything to be exposed properly. And so people have tried to design those kinds of integrated chips to put in the eye. And there's some success, still experimental, but some success in helping people see, help them regain vision. Okay, so if I'm going to use stem cells to make this, I'm making a rather complicated structure. Okay, so that's the challenge that we're focusing on. So let's say a little bit more about how the disease goes. So this is just another diagram of what I just showed you. And what we've done is that we've expanded part of it out. So here's one slice of bread, the mustard mayonnaise, another slice of bread for the pigment epithelium. The photoreceptor bread is here, and these are the photosensitive parts of the eye. So we have blood vessels where they belong. These blood vessels are leaky. The pigment epithelium forms a barrier between the blood and the photosensitive cells. How many people have heard of a blood-brain barrier? Okay, this is, the retina is just part of the brain, but we, to be more specific about it, we say this is the outer blood retinal barrier. If there's an outer blood retinal barrier, there must be an inner blood retinal barrier. Those are those blood vessels that we were looking at in the other pictures, right? So the outer inner blood retinal barrier is up here somewhere. This is the outer blood retinal barrier here. And so we are very selective, the RPE is, in what it allows to get into the photoreceptor cells, to give them the right environment that they need to function properly. Well, when we start getting this drusen to form, so these cells are constantly eating off the tips of the photosensitive cells. The photosensitive cells are always growing from the base up here, which is, you know, it's upside down, but the base is here, and it's always making more light-sensitive membrane, and the pigment epithelium is always chomping it up off at the end. So that's how you're constantly getting renewal of these outer structures. So when the RPE becomes ineffective at digesting that material, that's part of your answer to your question of what's in there. It's a lot of fat, lipid or modified fat that is partially digested and being shunned out the bottom and adding to the layer of mayonnaise and mustard. Okay, so these are drusen forming. Here we see that even bigger. Okay, so this is what we might call the dry form of macular degeneration, because there are no blood vessels invading this space. This can progress to where blood vessels poke through the mayonnaise layer and even poke through the pigment epithelium. And now these blood vessels are growing where they don't belong. So and they're very leaky. So that's why in that last image you saw a lot of blood. And this RPE is supposed to be pumping fluid out of the retina. Fluid's always entering from this side, and it's always being pumped into this capillary bed down here. But if fluid accumulates because the RPE is not functioning anymore or it's overwhelmed, we would call this retinal edema. You may have heard that word. Okay? So.
Sorry, I have a question.
Yes?
Is this happening only at the fovea or somewhere all over there?
This is happening, the fovea and macula. This, yeah, the fovea is the pit, and then the macula is the surrounding area. And this is happening primarily there. So this is a disease of the macula, as opposed to retinitis pigmentosa, which I showed you, which is a disease of the periphery. So to review that, here was the hard drusen. The dry form of AMD is looking like this, where we see the blood. That's this form. This is the wet form. And we inject a drug that blocks vessel growth into the vitreous, into where your fist was in that balloon analogy. And you can stop this and even get it to regress as long as you catch it early. But in late stage of disease, this therapy is not effective. So what's happening when as this disease progresses? So I told you these cells can't be seen unless you stain them. Okay? So the stains I've been showing you up to now are things that you can see using a light microscope. These stains are fluorescent stains. So anything that takes up the dye, when you shine the right wavelength of light on it, will create its own light, and you can see it. Otherwise, everything looks black. So we've given a stain for the nuclei, for the cell bodies, and we can see one layer of red, two layers of red, three layers of red, fourth and fifth layers have been taken away. Okay? We can't see what's in between the layers of red because they're not labeled with anything that would show them. And this red label down here is the photosensitive part of the pigment epithelial cells. So that's in the space between this layer and the pigment epithelium layer of bread. And as this disease progresses, these layers don't change. This layer doesn't change very much. It's the photoreceptor layer, right? So the pigment epithelium is necessary for the health of the photoreceptor. And if it's not doing its job, we're losing cells. And eventually, we have just one layer here. Okay. If I treat these with stem cells, so I'm just getting ahead of myself a little bit, and I do it at this stage, I can slow this process down. But if I add the stem cells at these stages, I can't go backwards. And that's part of the problem that I want to get into. Okay. So we're going to transplant cells into this place. Here we're showing the eye. We're going to put a needle through, and we're going to create a local retinal detachment. Okay, so we're going to put this in the place where the roast beef was and inject a little bit of fluid, create a little bleb detachment. And it's in that space that we're going to put something, but the question is what? So we could add RPE, we could add photoreceptors, we could add both. We could put them as single cells, break them up from their normal associations so they're free-floating cells, and inject them as a suspension. Or we can put them in as a sheet. We can get the cells from animals. This is known as xenotransplant. I had a chairman of surgery who told me that xenotransplantation, he was speaking broadly, is only 5 years away and always will be. We can use fetal tissue. Human fetal tissue is available, but that's rare. It's hard to come by in the quantities that would need. And if we had any hope, it would be we would reach a day where it was rarely available. Or we can use adult tissue. But the source that is proving to be the most effective is to use embryonic stem cells or induced pluripotent cells or adult stem cells. So at this point, we have to ask, what is a stem cell? And so the first question is, what is a cell? I've been using the word as if you knew what it was. But in everyday life, non-biological life, what is a cell?
Prison.
Prison. Okay, you can think of a prison cell. That's how it's commonly used. But before we knew anything about biological cells, a cell was just a room. And so the first scientist to look at this, a Dutch name that I'll bastardize, so I won't say it, but Leeuwenhoek? Van Leeuwenhoek, thank you. Looked at a piece of onion skin and saw these little polygons, and to him it looked like a room, so he called them cells. And so stem cells are cells that can reproduce themselves in principle forever. One cell grows, divides, become two cells. Two cells grow, divide, become four cells. And this could go on and on and on, and no end to that. But stem cells can't do anything. All they could do is grow and divide and make a copy of themselves. So this doesn't get us very far. So, but we can persuade the cells to form one or more differentiated cell types. So when the cell grows and divides, one daughter cell becomes a stem cell, and the other daughter cell starts to become something else. A retina cell, a pigment epithelium cell, an intestinal cell. We can take stem cells and put them in our culture dish and persuade them to become one thing or another. The thing is, a differentiated cell is a very useful cell. It does whatever job we want it to do, but they're obligated to die. So if you think about this, the surface of the cornea, those cells die every 6 days. Every 6 days you have a new cornea. And that's good, because if you were to scratch your cornea, it's no big deal. Within 6 days, that will heal. Your skin will replace itself once a month, the lining of your intestines every 3 days, your blood replaced every 4 months, your bones replaced every 7 years. In fact, if you're of a certain age, the body you started out with is not the body you have now. It's been replaced 5 or 6 or 7 times. Okay, and so you always have a population of stem cells that will do that. They come in various flavors. Human embryonic stem cells are part of the early embryo, and we call them pluripotent. They have many potentials. They can become all the cells of the body. Okay. Adult stem cells can only do a few things. So blood stem cell can become, I don't know, 20 different cell types, but that's all. Your cornea stem cell can only become corneal cells. So one we would call multipotent can become multiple things. One we would call unipotent, it can only become one thing. Intestinal cells can be 4 or 5 different cell types, just as another example. Induced pluripotent stem cells. In principle, I could take any cell in the body. Most often, it's a cell we call a fibroblast that we can, you know, swap our cheek and collect some fibroblast cells. And we can treat them and convert them back to an embryonic stem cell-like cell. And there's some differences, but it's a pretty good replica of an embryonic stem cell. And the advantage of that is, if you want to study a patient's disease, one way is to make stem cells and then differentiate those into the organ or the tissue type that you want to study. And you can study the mechanism of disease, come up with a target to treat that disease, test the drugs that might treat that disease, do this all before going to animal studies. Right now in this country, you're obligated to do animal studies, but they're very expensive. We can cut through we could discover what drug to use and test it and have a sense that it's going to work in humans before we go to the expensive animal studies. The way it was done traditionally, you would go through animal studies, you'd say, this is a great drug, and then you would find out in humans it didn't work. Right? But if you know it's going to work in human and you know it can work in the animal, then the FDA is willing to let you put this into clinical trials. Okay. And we have adult stem cells. And I'll give some examples of each of their use. So here's my diagram again. You see I've added this green layer, which is called the sclera. It's white, actually. So when you look at the whites of their eye, you're looking at the sclera, and that goes all the way around. There's a space between that and the pigment epithelium. That's where the outer blood vessels are. The inner blood vessels were all found in here. Okay, and the sclera, when you get in front of the eye, becomes the cornea. And if we look at the junction between sclera and cornea, we call that the limbus, and this is where stem cells reside. All those stem cells that are going to resurface the cornea are found here. And for people that receive, say, a chemical burn and their limbus is gone, people have been using limbal transplants for a long time. It's essentially a stem cell transplant. And some people are actually making stem cells out of limbus to use for this kind of transplantation. The lens, its stem cell layer is found at the rim. So we say the equator. Imagine this as a disk, and going all around the disk are stem cells. And in children with cataract, if you go carefully and protect the outer shell and remove the cataract without disturbing the stem cells, you can make a new lens. Now, this has been only in a small clinical trial. A few years ago, I haven't seen the results of larger trial, but we have good reason to think that that can be a therapy in the future for congenital cataract. And maybe for adult, but there have been no trials that I'm aware of that involve adult lens. Okay, but we have here in fetal life, the ciliary margin is a generative layer. There's stem cells here, that as the eye gets bigger and bigger, this is where new cells are coming from. But in adult, it's kind of quiescent. In fish, it's active. So fish can replace their entire retina throughout their life, and their active zone is here at the ciliary margin. But stem cells are probably found throughout the retina and the pigment epithelium, but they're few in number, and it's hard to activate them again. So using adult stem cells for these retinal diseases is not considered a fruitful way to go at this point. Could change. So pigment epithelium, I told you you can't see cells, but you can see these because they have pigment in them, right? And if we look at these dishes at higher magnification, we can see these little polygons that struck von Leeuwenhoek, I never get his name right, struck him as cells. Okay, so this next slide is, this next image is incredibly intimidating, but I'm gonna try and make it simple. Oh my God, all right. So the blue is always the cell nuclei. It's that same stain we use over and over again. And this time we're using stains that highlight ganglion cells. And you could see with age, week 7, week 8, week 9, week 12, we're getting more and more of these ganglion cells in the middle. And OTX2, these are eventually going to become photoreceptors. They're not photoreceptors yet, but they're going to become that. And if we skip down to this bottom row, where we look at higher magnification, we can see some of the proteins. These are more advanced photoreceptor cells. They're not totally mature. But what's interesting is they're making synapses with the next layer down. So AP2 is labeling those bipolar cells. And between this layer of red and this layer of red where they synapse and talk to one another, we can see that as evidenced by this SV2 protein.
Larry?
Yeah?
Week 7, 8, and 9 of what?
So we take our embryonic stem cells, we feed them some goodies, and that converts them to anterior brain cells, okay, which are a stem cell that is pluripotent, is multipotent. It's no longer pluripotent. And then we take those goodies away and give other goodies, and we push them towards eye field.
To what?
Eye field. So that's the part of the anterior brain that's going to become the eye. And then we take those goodies away and we put more goodies, and we push those eye field genes towards pigment epithelium in retinal progenitor cells. We call these progenitor cells because they're not stem cells, they won't divide forever, but they will be, they're multipotent, they can become different types of cells. So if you look at this, week 21, it took half a year to get here. All right, so these are not experiments that are done fast. And so they're expensive both in time and money. Not all your starting neurospheres are going to progress to this point. Okay. Now, the big problem here is that these are spheres and they're small. So if I was to put this in the subretinal space, where the roast beef was, these cells can interact with the pigment epithelium, but these cells are in the center of a sphere. They can't interact with the rest of the host retina. And if I look at, let me show you the next slide. So here's a clinical trial that was actually done. It was published in 2012. There's a follow-up study in 2014. And what they did is take pigment epithelial cells and divided them into single cells and injected a single cell suspension. So here we're showing, you put in a tube for a light, you put in a tube for instruments, and here's another tube that's going and injecting the stem cells in this retinal detachment. These pipes, by the way, these tubes, are the size of a small paperclip. The diameter of a small paperclip is a little bit bigger than the size of these needles. And through the center of this, we're actually going to put instruments like scissors and things. It's pretty, wherever my engineers are, this is quite a feat. But what they showed, you'll notice they put their cells here. And after time, they grew and grew, and you could see the pigment. They didn't put it here in the center of the macula. And the reason they didn't is because people that volunteer for this are nearly blind, right? You're not going to get any recovery here, but they thought maybe if we put it at the fringe, we might recover some vision. It wasn't their main goal. Their main goal was, this is called the phase one trial, that's just is it safe. And what they demonstrated is we don't get an inflammatory response, we don't get an infection, we don't get a tumor to form. All these things that people were afraid of, fortunately that doesn't happen. So this is considered a great success. The improvement in vision was minimal to none. Now what's interesting, there are a lot of these clinical trials going on now, and people say, quantitatively, by our standard measures, we'd say the improvement in vision is minimal. But if you talk to the patient, they say, oh, I can see so much more than I could before. In terms of my quality of life, it's made a difference. Okay. So we'd like to treat this person and help them get vision in their help restore vision, not just prevent it. In other words, we want to be able to add something here and help this patient recover vision. Okay. Truth in advertising, this is actually a mouse, but it's the same
idea. Can you go back one slide? I have a quick question.
Yeah.
How much time between A and C? What's the
time here? I don't recall. Probably 6 months.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So,
in animal studies, the cell suspensions organize themselves into focal areas?
That's a great question. So in the animal studies, do the cells reorganize into appropriate layers? And I'm going there right now. So this is I'll give you $5 at the end. You're asking great questions. Okay, so this is one of these vesicles or eye cups that I just showed you. There's another way to do this that's called the rosette. So let's look at one of these. If this is right side out, this is inside out. So the cells that need to integrate with the host retina are facing outwards instead of being in the center here. But the problem is the light sensitive cells in here can't interact with the pigment epithelium. So, and when you put in this collection, they don't reorganize. This group of cells has been in this animal, which I think is a monkey, could be a pig. Those are the two favorite models. Cells after a month look like the cells that got put in. But we see that the cells on the outside were able to grow up into the host retina and integrate, which is a great advance, or it's a great discovery. So the way I want to go forward with this is I want to grow retinal progenitor cells not as a sphere, but as a flat sheet. So people know how to do this, to grow pigment epithelium on a filter. And depending what lab you want, you go to, the filters are made of different material, it doesn't matter. These red boxcars, this is the RPE. It naturally grows as a flat sheet. If I create a scaffold that is planar and put that on top of the pigment epithelium and seed that with retinal progenitor cells, the hypothesis is, and there's data to support it now, these cells will help the RPE become more mature, which will secrete things that will help the retina become more mature, and this crosstalk, this cycle, will repeat itself over and over. As cell layers develop, this cell layer influences the differentiation of this cell layer, which feeds back and furthers the differentiation of this cell layer. So here's a picture, a scanning electron microscope view of my scaffold. I can seed that with cells. And if I do this cell culture, I see many layers of photoreceptor cells. If you recall the previous image, we had just one row of photoreceptor cells. Now we have many, many. And we also have a much thicker inner layers, which I'm not going to take the time to show you the stains of what kinds of cells those might be. So we've gone on to put these into a mouse model. So here is the top slice of bread. Here's the next slice of bread down. The photoreceptor slice is gone. This is an antibody for human cells, so it doesn't light up any of the mouse cells. And we've seen that we've added some rows of photoreceptor-like cells. And some of our cells have also gone to populate the RPE, which at this stage is getting sick and die. Just as the RPE supports the photoreceptors support the pigment epithelium. If one dies, the other layer dies. So these are the kinds of experiments that we're doing. And I'm going to skip, for the interest of time, we can go back to these slides, and just say that different regions of the retina have different functions. Macula is one region that's for visual acuity and is the subject of a disease we want to treat. The retina is multi-layered integrated circuit board, and much of the circuitry can be recreated on a small scale in a dish. We're trying to recreate it on a larger scale that would be useful for transplantation. And retinal cells can be safely implanted into the human eye. A number of studies have shown this now. But we need more study in animals to make this a viable therapy. So with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention, and I'm happy for any questions. So,
how do you get a sheet to go in perfectly like a sheet?
Okay.
What you've grown on the scaffold.
Yeah, so how do we put in a sheet? That was the video that we can't get to work. But several labs, each has their favorite engineered tool for, won't work through the 23-gauge cannula, so what they have to do is enlarge that incision for a tool that's still pretty small, that you can slip into this retinal bleb push the filter or the 3D scaffold in as a sheet. So actually, that's not the problem. The engineers and the surgeons are way ahead of the cell biology and physiology here. So this is why we need the animal studies. So studies in primates are very difficult to do in the United States, but in Japan, that's a favorite model. In the United States, we're using more pigs because the pig eye is the same size as a human eye. It has a lot of the same physiology and some of the same anatomy. So that's becoming a model for trying to develop eye surgery. Whatever works in the eye, in the pig eye, those tools and instruments will go right into the human OR. In fact, when I do a surgery, I can't do it. I bring in a couple of surgeons and an anesthesiologist and about $400,000 worth of equipment that companies give us a price break because they say, look, I'm not going to make any money on this. I don't have any patient fees to help pay for my instrument. Please give me a discount. And so some of them do. But actually, that reminds me, I left up what's maybe the most important slide. And that's, yeah, if we could turn that light off. That these are the people in the lab that actually, you know, do the work. Lulongi and Peter have gone in their into their residency programs for ophthalmology. Xiaomin Peng has gone back to China, where he's head of a large eye hospital. Current people in the lab are Depti Singh and Xiaomin Wang, and several medical students that work with them. Ron Edelman is my surgeon, and Bo Chen is a retinal specialist who has worked with me. I'm indebted to the Yale Stem Cell Center that's celebrating its 10th year this year. And they're supported, and I'm directly supported, by the Connecticut Regenerative Medicine Research Fund. And I also receive funding from the Department of Defense and several family funds. And so your name can appear here, right next to these other, you know, very kind, generous individuals who make this work possible.
Why Department of Defense? What do they care?
So the Department of Defense has a biological research effort that's focused on treating veterans, but more important, battlefield injuries. And so the way I'm mimicking age-related macular degeneration and several other labs that are doing this kind of work is to create a light laser burn. On the battlefield, laser burns are a problem. So I create light laser burns and more severe laser burns, and I'm trying to see if I can correct them with the tissues that we're implanting. So the macular degeneration work and the Defense Department's interest in battlefield injuries dovetail, and that's why they're willing to support this. Okay. Yeah?
How does someone become a volunteer?
Clinical trials actively go out and recruit people. So where it's advertised, I'm not entirely sure. You know, Carol, you used to recruit people for genetic studies, but. There's centers in Massachusetts, Columbia University was one, out in California. There's a group in London that are looking for patients for this kind of work.
Do you have any lists of those particular ones? Because I've gone on government trials.
Yeah. Yeah. So you can send me an email. I don't have right off the top of my head. I'm writing a review article about this, and I have a collection of people that have active studies going on. And I can send it to, you know, just to my name, firstname.lastname@yale.edu, and that'll get to me.
I think.
Yeah, and I think I have a card with me, so okay. You can see me afterwards.
But I just have a question to you. So you went to the NIH website, which
yeah.
has clinical trials yeah. listed and was not up in the news?
No, I didn't see any that offer stem cells that are currently moving. And I've been looking for years.
It's not straightforward how to search it, but you
no.
can find it.
Yeah.
The way I do it is I tell my medical student, find active studies, and they know how to do this.
There are two other ways that you can look. One is if you is ask your personal physician.
Yes, oh,
right.
We did that. And they
sure.
don't. They didn't spend the time to look into it. They mm-hmm. said they would let us know and that
and
they didn't.
Later. And
yeah.
the other place is to call the head of the department. So like where Larry is at Yale, and of course you have, you can write a letter directly to Larry, but the chair of the department at Hopkins, the chair of the department at Columbia, and speak with the administrative folks.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, Carol, if I can say that again, because you're not being picked up by the mic for the TV. The question was, how can I find out about clinical trials? Searching the government websites is difficult if you don't have knowledge. But you can ask your physician, and you can also call the chairman at different departments. The new chairman at Yale, actually, was on one of these clinical, was on the paper that I showed you. He didn't do the transplants, but he was associated with that study. So he would know about that one. I know someone out in California who's doing studies now. That's the best way. If you don't know how to do the right search terms, the government site can be very tricky.
So when the cell layers get sloughed off, actually, are they getting sloughed off as it becomes thinner?
What's happening to the cells that are dying? I don't know.
Okay, because the
pigment epithelium might be eating them because it's a professional phagocytic cell.
Yeah, okay.
I don't believe that macrophages are invading that space to do it. But when you have a choroidal neovascularization, now you've got macrophage all over the place, besides the RPE. And actually, the macrophage can be beneficial, at least early on, because if the pigment epithelium isn't digesting spent rod outer segments or cone outer segments, the macrophage can do it.
Yeah.
And so there's kind of a supportive effect. So if you do a sham surgery, macrophages come in and the rodents improved vision. People were puzzling, but I didn't put anything in. I just did a sham surgery. And it was because macrophages were coming in and having an effect that wears off after time. If you put in a transplant, the effect is much longer. In the back. Yeah, so the question was about the inner tissues and how do they get their nutrition. So when I showed you those pictures of looking in with the ophthalmoscope, and those are the only blood vessels you could see, right? That's the inner blood retinal barrier. So that's giving nutrition to the inner layers. Where we had that geographic atrophy, where I could show you the choroidal blood vessels, right, that was the blood supply for the outer layers of retina. Okay. So there's a sandwich of blood vessels, inner on both sides, precisely.
So how is the dry one treated?
How is dry AMD treated? Well, if you start getting a lot of drusen, so you don't have visual loss, but you've got drusen and your risk factors are high, there's a vitamin therapy that will retard the onset. So everyone's going to go out and say, what's this vitamin therapy, and let me try it. If you don't have drusen, it won't work. There's no benefit to it. You have to be in the early stages of disease, and then this will slow it a little bit, but it's not a great therapy.
So it's a local application of the vitamin?
No, I believe it's oral.
Oh.
But
it's Arid's formula. It's based on all the research studies.
Yeah.
Just basically antioxidants in beta form, but all the...
Right. The comment is there's a study, Ares, A-R-E-S, one and two, that tested various therapies. And you're right, they're mostly antioxidants and zinc, I think, vitamin C. You know. So this therapy does not have fabulous results. It's better than nothing, but... We need a better therapy. Yeah.
How important would you say it is to shield your eyes from the sun? Because my husband doesn't believe it's important.
So I'm being asked to wade into marital discord. Should my husband be wearing sunglasses? And ultraviolet radiation comes in three flavors, and they're generally not good for your eye.
Right.
So you should wear lots of studies on that. Yes.
What are the other risk factors?
AMD? I believe smoking, like everything else, smoking is a risk factor. The biggest risk factor is age. So don't get old. We can't find a diet connection. There is a genetic connection, okay, and that stems from the and that's been a very interesting connection, because it implicates the immune system. So you have two kinds of immune system, basically. If you're one of those people that likes to divide the world in two, there are two kinds of immune system. There's the acute immune system, when you have an infection, you know, and the body goes crazy and fights the infection. But there is a low-grade immune system, an innate immune system, that repairs tissue damage that goes on every day in your life. So it's a normal process of repairing the everyday wear and tear on your body. When this gets out of hand and becomes a chronic inflammation, it's sometimes referred to as a subclinical inflammation, that results in disease. So Parkinson's disease is thought to be a subclinical inflammatory process. So is macular degeneration, bowel disease. There are a growing number of these diseases where they're finding the immune system getting a little out of control. Is lupus one too? I'm not sure.
Is that the same thing as autoimmune?
No. Autoimmune is autoimmune is your body's attacking itself. Right? It's not part of a normal process.
So couldn't you literally research what causes inflammation in the body, like as far as your diet, sugar, and you know other things, and eliminate them as much as possible?
So is there a way, if I could restate your question, is there a way through diet, try to find those elements that support subclinical inflammatory process and thereby be better? Okay, so yeah, you know, there's a whole health food industry devoted to that, but at the scientific level, the research level, yeah, I mean, people look for those things. That you know, support NIH research and your favorite foundation and all of that, because those kinds of studies are ongoing and underfunded.
Is there a link to anticoagulant therapy, Coumadin, and the development of the web kind, or possibly fibrillation?
So is Coumadin a therapy that's related to this? And no. No, the therapy is an antibody a mouse antibody to a growth factor that's been humanized.
No, is it causative? She's asking, is it a risk factor of Coumadin therapy?
Is Coumadin therapy a risk factor? I see, I understand.
Is that your question?
Yeah, I don't know.
Or circulatory problems. The people I know all have atrial fibrillation.
Yeah, and atrial fibrillation, or well, what's the interrelation of these diseases? And I'm unaware of a connection. I'd have to go to my clinical colleagues to
was
get there.
Was your research affected much by the ban on stem cell research from years back?
Was my research affected by the ban of stem cell research years back? And so right now there are a collection of stem cell lines that are approved by the government. They're not enough because one stem cell line is not the same as another. There's variations in what they can do and what tissues you can push them towards, and there's always a need for more. So the Connecticut Stem Cell Fund especially likes to fund unapproved cell lines that are being developed for one purpose or another. But I can't do stem cell research in my building because 30, 40 years ago it was renovated in part with federal funds. So Yale had to build a new building for stem cell research, and that's, other institutions, the same thing. And then not all the work there is supported by federal government. So we would have to have two centrifuges, one for stem cell work that was not approved by the government, and one that was, I'd need two bottles of salt. I'd need two bottles of everything. Because the funding sources had to be kept separate, so. But that's gotten a bit better in recent years.
Is there a movement to reduce that silliness?
I'm not going to take the bite and wade into a political discussion, much as I am wanting to. But. No one could fund this research besides government. I mean, the family funds here are incredibly valuable because I can spend their money on things that break the rules of various funding agencies. So they give me flexibility, but they can't pay the salaries of my people. They can't pay my animal costs. They can't pay the big bulk. So I rely on big agencies like the Connecticut Research Fund and Department of Defense, the National Institute of Health. But it's very, the money relative to the number of excellent grants is small. And so funding's a big problem. So if that's important to you, then when you vote for congressmen and senators and presidents and the like, that should be on your radar. In the back.
I heard on the news, it's off the subject, but I heard on the news a week ago that they released all the monkeys, I guess, from any kind of research. Now it's illegal to use. So they have thousands and thousands of apes that.
Yeah. So the question is about monkeys and great apes that are being retired from research.
No, this stopped.
Yeah, no, well, yes. They've stopped that kind of work, and now you have these animals that I think the article that you're referring to was about transferring animals to a zoo in London, and why not a zoo in the United States, or something along those lines. But it's become very difficult to do primate work in the United States.
And why just primates and not the dogs and the cats and the rats?
Why not? Why are primates singled out? They're the most human-like, I guess. They have personalities. But I got to tell you, pigs have personalities. It's and dogs and cats. But this type of work, properly done, properly regulated, is essential. And folks that tell you otherwise, stem cells aren't going to get rid of that. In fact, I'm studying stem cells by putting them in animal models to understand, because you can't learn everything you need to learn in a culture dish.
I think that's an excellent way to end this conversation. which I think everybody has questions about. So I'm going to share your email address.
Sure.
People. And the next time we meet is October 29th in this same space. And Patrick Sweeney from the Peabody Museum is going to come and talk about digitization of natural history collections. And it should be really interesting. I've heard him speak before about, especially the botanical collections, which people don't really notice when they go to Peabody. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you. My pleasure. Oh, immune rejection, yes, that's a problem. The eye is somewhat of a privileged site, but we're talking about diseases where the blood-brain barrier has broken down, and so they're perhaps not so immune protected. And and that's a big reason for the induced pluripotent cells. And the notion is, if we can create a library of 20, 100, I don't know how many you would need, that were tissue typed, so that you wouldn't necessarily have to take the stem cell from the patient, but you'd have on the shelf a cell line that's well behaved for your application, and it has the right tissue markers, histocompatibility markers, that you can avoid that. But that's a notion that's been kicking around. I don't know if that's gone anywhere. Okay.